Okay, good morning. In the lecture series of lecture series by our own palliative medicine physician post MDs, in between two lectures from international expert, we are about to getting over of this series also. So in this lecture series, next lecture is by Dr. Vikram Pratap. Vikram is a senior resident at AIIMS New Delhi. He has completed MD in our department at AIIMS New Delhi. He is quite an active worker in the department, in the sense that he is participating in almost all the conferences and workshops. Besides this, he is also very sincere and he towards the patients, their needs. So he's really looking after patient in a holistic way. He has not only worked for the conferences and workshop, but he has also presented posters and oral presentation in various conferences, and he is also trying to publish papers in various journals. So he's trying to improve his academics also. So let's listen to him. That very important topic for the day is neuromuscular disorder. So whenever a patient of neuromuscular disorders comes, when it is there, how palliative care integration, principles of palliative care, how this integration will help in a patient with neuromuscular disorder, when we really many a times we feel helpless that how to help this patient. But we can do at every circumstances. That is what we have learned in palliative medicine, and how we can help a patient who is suffering with neuromuscular disorder. So Vikram has really worked hard to prepare this topic, because we rarely see all these patients. But let's listen to Vikram, that how he will try to present and how we will try to help you in improving your knowledge to look after patients with neuromuscular disorders. So Vikram, please go ahead. Arun will keep the question answer track. Please write down your question answer in the chat box. We will take care of all the question and answer at the end. Please go ahead, sir. Vikram.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am, for the introduction.
Tumhari awaaz thodi dheemi hai, Vikram. Awaaz tez karo.
Thank you, ma'am, for the introduction. Good morning, everyone.
Theek hai, Vikram. Go ahead.
Good morning, everyone. Today, I am presenting a seminar on a topic of neuromuscular disorder. Myself, Dr. Vikram, senior resident in Department of Palliative Medicine, AIIMS. Today we discuss neuromuscular disorder. Neuromuscular disorder are characterized by progressive muscle weakness leading to pronounced and incapacitated physical disability. Most neuromuscular disorders are hereditary and are not amenable to curative treatment, and would thus qualify his quality of life. Then we introduce palliative care in neuromuscular disorder. Palliative care is an approach that improves the quality of life of patient and their family facing the problem associated with life-threatening illness. Now, definition of neuromuscular disorder. The term neuromuscular disease defined disorder of the motor unit and excluded influence on motor muscular function from the brain, such as spasticity. The motor unit has four components. We see in this diagram. A is motor unit in the brainstem or anterior horn of the spinal cord. B is axon with other axon forming the peripheral nerve. C is neuromuscular junction. And D is myopathies, all muscle fiber innervated by a single motor neuron. And our seminar is also divided in these four categories. First we discuss motor neuron disease. In this motor neuron disease or anterior horn cell disorder, disease that can involve Benz cell of the motor cortex, the lower cranial nerve motor nuclei, the corticospinal tract, and or the anterior horn cell. It's included amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, which is seen in 80% of patients out of 100, progressive bulbar palsy 10%, progressive muscular atrophy or spinal muscular atrophy 8%, and primary lateral sclerosis 2%. Now we discuss amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. It is also known as Lou Gehrig disease, from the famous basketball player Lou Gehrig. It's a progressive fatal neurodegenerative disorder. in which destruction of both upper and lower motor neuron in the brain and spinal cord. Due to upper motor neuron lesion, patient complained of spasticity, clonus, and hyperreflexia. For lower motor neuron, patient complained of weakness, atrophy, and fasciculation. And there is no known cure till date. In clinical scenario, 80% patient complained with limbic onset and 20% bulbar onset. It's a progressive involvement of all limb and axial muscles. Progressive impairment of oral, pharyngeal, and respiratory muscle causes patient is unable to speak, swallow, and breathing difficulty. And patient is completely dependent for activity of daily living and near total paralysis, but relatively sparing of extraocular movement and bladder and bowel function. Median survival is 3 to 5 years, but is highly variable survival time. Prognosis can be modified to some degree by treatment option, and approximately 10% of patients with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis survive more than 10 years. And patient is expire mainly from the respiratory failure. Then what are the factors associated with short survival if they are present at diagnosis? Speech and swallowing problem, weight loss, poor respiratory function, older age, cognitive changes, and shorter time from developing symptom to the time of diagnosis. Event-reduced palliative care in amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. Palliative care role is, it controls symptoms, discuss goal of patient and family, and assistant with transition of care. This was the article published in 2015 in BMJ Journal. In which specialized palliative care improved the quality of life in advanced neurodegenerative disorder. It's a pilot randomized control study. This RCT demonstrating improvement in quality of life and symptom burden in advanced in ALS and other neurodegenerative disorder with early referral to specialized level palliative care. Another study done in 2013 in which multidisciplinary ALS care improved quality of life in patient with ALS. It's a collaborative effort, important role for multiple disciplines throughout disease course. Multidisciplinary ALS clinic developed in various countries, which cause early access to specialized therapy, improve coordination of care. Due to involvement of multidisciplinary team, increased median survival 19 months versus 11 months in retrospective review of 417 patients, and also improve quality of life of patient. What are the multidisciplinary teams? Firstly, physician, neurologist, palliative care specialist, gastroenterologist, nurse, social worker, occupational and physical therapist, speech and language pathologist, pulmonologist, dietitian, and psychologist. There is one drug which acts in the ALS, riluzole. Riluzole is a glutamate inhibitor, only medication approved for the treatment of ALS. It prolongs survival or time of tracheostomy by 2 to 3 months. Modest slowing of decline in limb and bulbar function, but does not reverse or improve existing symptoms. No evidence regarding impact on quality of life. And main side effect is GI symptoms like nausea and vomiting and fatigue. Now we discuss symptom management in ALS patient. Pain, especially muscle cramp and spasticity, dysarthria, pseudobulbar effect, cognitive impairment, dysphagia, salivation and nutrition, dyspnea, choking and respiration. And lastly, we discuss end of life issues. This was the article published in Lancet Neurological 2016. In this article, pain is a largely neglected symptom in patient with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, although it is reported by most of the patient. And pain is correlated with a deterioration in patient quality of life and increased prevalence of depression. Given the multifactorial nature of pain in patient with ALS, different treatment has been suggested, ranging from NSAIDs, drug for neuropathic pain, opioids and cannabinoids, and to physical therapy strategies and preventing assistant device. If you see this diagram, in front of the patient, there are several painful sites like facial pressure ulcer due to NIV mask, pain due to suction of saliva or sputum, or to ventilator hose being or pulling, shoulder pain due to reduced mobility cause shoulder pain due to articular pain, itching, diffuse itching, spasticity, spasm or clonus in the lower limb, painful cramps in the lower limb, hands and abdomen, and joint contracture due to reduced mobility. From the backside, neck pain due to hypothesia of neck muscle, back pain due to reduced mobility, pressure sores due to reduced mobility, and neuropathic pain, mainly in the distal extremities, diffuse or foam. In pain, 45 to 64% of neuromuscular disorders patients have pain. Pathology of pain in MND is complex and multifactorial. NSAIDs, opioid, calcium, and bisphosphonates have role in this patient. For skin pressure and edema, we give good pressure, area care, and massage, opioid analgesia, and diuretics. Now we discuss cramp, occurring up to 95% of patients of neuromuscular disorder. For non-pharmacological therapy, we give stretching, positioning, and massage. For pharmacological therapy, we give antiepileptic like levetiracetam, phenytoin, carbamazepine, benzodiazepine. We give diazepam 2 to 5 mg TDS, baclofenac 5 to 10 mg TDS up to 60 mg daily, quinine 300 mg HS, but no longer recommended due to risk of toxicity. Maxillotine, it's a class 1B antiarrhythmic drug. Recent phase 2 randomized controlled trial study saw reduction in cramp frequency and intensity. Second, we discuss spasticity. It's result in pain, contraction, and fall. Interfere with care. For non-pharmacological, we give stretching, positioning, and massage. And pharmacological, we give baclofen, diazepam. Clonazepam, we give 0.25 mg daily up to 2 to 4 mg daily. Gabapentin 300 mg TDS. Dentolin 25 mg daily up to 400 mg daily. Tizanidine 2 mg daily to maximum 24 mg daily. And we also set consultation for physiotherapy. For our aim is to maintain joint range of movement, prevent contracture, reduce stiffness and discomfort. Can be resistance, active assistant or passive exercise. And also check to see if family or care can assist in the program. Now we second symptom we discussed dysarthria. Dysarthria is due to weakness and wasting of tongue, lip, facial muscle, pharynx and laryngeal muscle. Progressive difficulty with articulation, slurred speech and or loss of volume. Its prevalence is up to 80%. Due to this dysarthria, patient feel isolation due to communication inadequate or avoided, feel frustration, difficulty or impossible to be understood, need time which may not be available, increased fear and anxiety because unable to discuss this fear and anxiety due to dysarthria, low self-esteem, others out or think intellectually impaired, loss of control because misunderstood or opinion ignored or not sought, increased sadness due to isolation and frustration felt by patient, caregivers and family members. We sent early referral to speech and language therapist, advice on strategy for communication, assess and provision of communication aid. If speech is impaired, we go for augmentation communication, like we give hypophonia patient for voice amplifier. If speech is totally absent, then we use alternate communication, like we see in diagram is letter. What are the useful strategy to aid communication? Take time and create a quiet, relaxed atmosphere. Set an individual on preferred communication strategy and or equipment use. Position, if you talk to the patient face to face, watch patient lip, eye and gesture. Ask close question for yes or no answer. Use signal for yes or no. Encourage patient to slow down and over emphasize word and be wary of interruption or trying to finish patient sentence first. Next is pseudobulbar effect. Pseudobulbar effect is sudden uncontrolled outburst of laughter or crying due to degeneration of corticobulbar tract occur in multiple neurological conditions which lead to embarrassment, social isolation and associated with reduced quality of life. And sometimes due to excessive outburst crying can be mistaken for depression. We educate patient and family. We give trial of dextromethorphan, quinidine 20 mg or 10 mg. And we also give tricyclic antidepressant or SSRIs. Next is cognitive impairment occurring in approximately 50% of patients with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, ranging from subtle finding to dementia, deficit in executive function, but memory relatively preserved in ALS patient. Frontotemporal dementia seen in 50% of patient, but need to consider capacity in medical decision making and goal of care decision. Now we discuss dysphagia, salivation and nutrition. Dysphagia affect about 2/3 of all the patient eventually. It is due to weakness and paralysis of the bulbar muscle, which causes loss of ability to form lips, chew proper food with the tongue, poor or absent swallowing reflex, failure to close airway, muscle spasm, due to which patient is dehydrated and weight loss, and impaired respiratory function. What are the key principles for the dysphagia? Good oral hygiene, assessment of eating and monitoring swallowing, nutritional intake and weight, head support and position, mainly left lateral position. And we involve gastroenterologists for percutaneous endoscopic gastrostomy and always look for aspiration. For sialorrhea, sialorrhea is an excessive drooling, can be managed by minimization of sweet and sour food, which stimulate the salivary gland, suction, posture, head support, diet, swallowing, and oral care we give to the patient. We also give trial of tricyclic antidepressant, amitriptyline, 10 to 25 mg HS. We also give atropine tablet or syrup. In market's name is Donalix Elixir, 5 to 10 ml TDS or QID daily, or Donatav, 1 to 2 tablet TDS or QID daily. We also give trial of glycopyrrolate, 0.2 mg subcutaneous TDS or QID daily. Hyoscine, 400 to 600 mites subcutaneous 2 to 4 hourly. We also give botulinum toxin or radiotherapy therapy. May provide benefit in case of severe drooling. In this article published in International Journal of Pediatric Dentists in 2017, which have sublingual administration of atropine, eye drop in children with excessive drooling. It's a pilot study. Drooling can be a severe disability and high impact on daily life. Sublingual administration of atropine eye drop is a useful reversible treatment option for severe drooling in children with disability. In this article, author gave 4 weeks with atropine eye drop solution, 10 mg per ml, once drop per day, followed by 4 weeks of one drop twice a day. It's after 4 weeks, unstimulated salivary secretion rate decreases from baseline to end of study, and no irreversible side effects were noted. Author concluded that sublingual atropine eye drop may be an alternate for treatment of severe drooling in children with disability. Normally, atropine eye drop used with clozapine induced sialorrhea mainly. Now we discuss dry mouth. Difficulty with expectoration and mucus plugging may be exacerbated by anticholinergic medication used to treat sialorrhea. Check fluid intake, rehydration, and avoid mouth breathing. Maintain good oral hygiene. We give hydroscopic agent like papaine, mucoidine carboxystin 250 mg per 5 ml. We also use some natural remedies like pineapple, peas, apple, lemon, grape juice, or flavored ice cube. Nebulize hypertonic saline. Use of mucolytic includes guanfacine and N-acetylcysteine. And expectoration of secretion can also be facilitated by use of cough assistant device. Now we talk about nutrition. Nutrition have significant cause of concern for both patient and caregivers. But due to multiple barriers like physical impairment to feeding, arm weakness, progressive dysphagia, fear of choking, we discuss gastrostomy early and regularly. One of the article published in 2016, we suggested that if patient BMI is less than 18.5, then associated with shorter survival. Now, what are the management part? Involvement of nutritionist and speech and swallowing therapist. Modification of food consistency, add thickener to liquid, advice on positioning, mainly lateral position, sitting, and maintain posture, multiple swallow with each bite, avoid distraction while eating, addition of calorie-rich foods, and we also give oral supplements. For feeding tube, considered with weight loss, insignificant oral intake, dehydration, or choking episode. What are the benefits of this feeding tube? Stabilize weight loss, improve overall survival time, possible improvement of quality of life, assess for medication, and can continue to eat as tolerated for pleasure without pressure of maintaining nutrition. but there is a risk of complication from procedure, blockage, infection. It does not eliminate risk of aspiration. Now, what we are doing for this aspiration, we go for PEG feeding. PEG feeding, we are give advice for patient for unexplained weight loss, unable to feed themselves, dysphagia, recurrent aspiration or choking on oral feed. And it also used for hydration and medication purpose, but considered whether the PEG feeding is appropriate, acceptable, ethical, and improve the quality of life of patient. For respiratory impairment due to progressive weakness of muscle of respiration due to hypoventilation, best monitored by serial vital capacity. If it's less than 50%, predicted frequently associated with respiratory symptom. If it is less than 30%, there is a risk of respiratory failure or death. What are the earliest signs of this respiratory impairment? Daytime fatigue, headache due to CO2 retention, orthopnea, and nighttime dyspnea. What are the key principles of this respiratory impairment? Assessment and treatment of additional underlying cause like rule out pulmonary edema, pneumonia, and bronchospasm. Relief, fear, and anxiety. Reassurance and give medication like oral or parenteral morphine can reduce the distress of breathing. Benzodiazepine, concurrent use of the management of secretion. But remember, supplement oxygen not recommended in absence of overt hypoxia. If patient have a choking episode, considered MIDAS with or without morphine, we use glycopyrrolate with NPPI. Plus breathing exercise, chest physiotherapy, and positioning is the main role. We talk about non-NIV, non-invasive positive pressure ventilation. It's improved survival time. There is one study in which 41 patients, survival advantage of 205 days in ALS patient without severe bulbar dysfunction using non-invasive ventilation compared to standard therapy. Advantage of this NIV is to improve the quality of life and survival, decrease the work of breathing and decrease the need for intubation, adequate blood loss, and patient can communicate, eat or drink. Then what we considered NIV, there is one criteria published in Link et al. In 2003, in which respiratory symptom plus functional vital capacity less than 80% predicted and significant nocturnal desaturation plus morning PCO2 more than 6.5 kilopascal. But not all patients with MND can tolerate NIV. Then options are limited to tracheostomy or palliation. Then what about mechanical ventilation? Should be discussed early on ongoing basis. Avoid decision making in emergency situation. Highly personal decision. View may change over time, but implement in only 10% of the ALS patient. Now we discuss end of life issue. We discuss breaking bad news, good communication and family meeting, symptoms at the end of life and reassurance, resuscitation. We give sedation, hydration and feeding by PEG, withdrawal NIV, advanced care directive or medical power of attorney. We offer site of death to the patient, either patient die at home or in hospital or hospice. This was the article published in 2016 in Elsevier, in which advanced care decision discussion with young people affected by life-limiting neuromuscular disease. It's a systematic literature review and narrative decision. Synthesis. Despite well-documented understanding of the progression of life-limiting neuromuscular disease, the majority of patients affected by such condition die without a formal end-of-life care plan in place. The review found a very limited body of literature regarding end-of-life care conversation between young people affected by neuromuscular disease and health professionals. There is a shared reluctance of patient care, family cares, and healthcare professional to initiate the end-of-life care discussion. In terminal care, our key symptoms in terminal phase of MND include respiratory distress, failure, terminal restlessness, severe pain, choking episode. We give regular parenteral morphine or transdermal opioid fentanyl, unneeded along with regular benzodiazepine like MIDAS and anticholinergic drug like hyoscine. The dose depend on prior opioid use and symptom burden. Palliative sedation will be required if patient is restlessness, delirious, or is withdrawn from the NIV. Family support and good communication with the family is important. Now, when we send patient for hospice, a patient is critically impaired breathing capacity, like vital capacity less than 40% of normal, dyspnea at rest, orthopnea, weakened cough, or other sign of respiratory decline, and patient is declined mechanical ventilation. Rapid progression of ALS and critical nutritional impairment, evident by bedbound status of the patient, barely or unintelligible speech, dysphagia require puris, progressive weight loss, and dependency in activity of daily living. This was the article published in 2016 in ELSPAS, breaking the news of a diagnosis of motor neuron disease. It's a national survey in Australia of neurologist perspective. In this survey, nearly 70% of neurologists reported finding it somewhat to very difficult communicating with the MND disease, and 65% reported feeling moderate to high stress and anxiety at the delivery of diagnosis. Second journal published in same year in 2016, family carers' experience of receiving the news of a diagnosis of motor neuron disease. It's again published is national survey in Australia, in which 2/3 of the family carers rated the skill of their neurologist as above average and were satisfied with the delivery of the diagnosis in terms of having a significant longer consultation time, the neurologist being warm and caring, satisfaction with the amount and content of information they received and the relevant support, and a plan for following up support. Conversely, those who rated the neurological skills as below average commented on the difficulty they encountered and the long-term emotional stress endangered by poor communication. Though this study require, neurologists may require education and training in communicating the diagnosis, and this should include family carers as a vital member in motor neuron disease care. Now we discuss second disease in anterior horn cell disease or motor neuron, spinal muscular atrophy. It's a degenerative disease of the anterior horn cell of the spinal cord and cranial nerve nuclei in the brainstem. Spinal muscular atrophy is caused by mutation of the survival of the motor neuron SMN1 gene, resulting in SMN protein deficiency. It's autosomal recessive, located in chromosome 5q. Its incidence is 1 ratio 10,000 of live birth. It's a three types. Type 1, Wernicke-Hoffmann disease. It's a most severe, diagnosed less than 6 months of age, death less than 18 months, and life expectancy is less than 2 years. Its second type is Dubovitz disease. It's a milder form than one, diagnosed less than equal to 18 months, life expectancy more than 2 years. Third is Guillain-Barré disease. It's the mildest form, diagnosed by age of 18 months, early adolescent, life expectancy is adult. If you see this diagram, there is a lack of head support, hypotonia, frog-like posture, and tongue fasciculation. These are the characteristic findings of this spinal muscular atrophy. Others are generalized weakness, severe hypotonia, proximal and distal muscle of limb, intercostal muscle and chest deformity, absent deep tendon reflexes, bulbar muscle palsy, history of decreased fetal movement in utero, breathing difficulty, paradoxical respiration, feeding difficulty, floppy infant, frequent severe respiratory tract inflammation. But in this patient, IQ is always normal. What are the investigation we do? We send for cytokeratin kinase, normal or mildly increased, nerve conduction studies, electromyography, muscle biopsy, genetic detection, and supportive care. There is one drug, nusinersen. It's an antisense oligonucleotide that promotes the production of full-length SMN protein and is administered intrathecally. Trials show that there is improvement, but not all children are responder. Improvement is often only partial, and long-term efficacy is as yet unknown, as no treatment can stop or delay the progression in spinal muscular atrophy. Now we go from the second slide again. Now we discuss second part of this lecture, this axon with other axon forming the peripheral nerve disorders. Peripheral nerve disorder, we discuss Guillain-Barré syndrome. It's an inflammatory disorder of the peripheral nerve, rapidly progressing predominantly motor, symmetric, and polyreticulopathy. 1 to 2 per 1 lakh patient, more than one limb involvement. Leg are the first site, then trunk, then arm, then neck, then face. Causes are unknown. Autoimmune destruction of myelin and or axon, association with immunization, and preceded by infection. Most significant within 4 weeks, ascending muscle weakness, pain, aching type in the shoulder, thigh and lumbar region, dysphagia, dysarthria, facial weakness and ophthalmoplegia, minimal loss of sensation on examination, decrease or absent tendon reflex. On investigation, we send for CSF, elevated protein, normal cell count within 1 week, electromyography, nerve biopsy, if other fails, we go for sural nerve biopsy, ECG, so sometime arrhythmias, and other investigation according to the cause. Management part, we give IV immunoglobulin at 2 g/kg over 2 to 5 days, or plasma exchange if present within 2 to 4 weeks. Palliative patient, we also care for, and we give anticoagulant to prevent thromboembolic syndrome episodes. Electively, we go for endotracheal intubation, tracheostomy, or mechanical ventilation. We give nutritional support, and most of the patient expire due to RDS or heart block. Second, in this peripheral nerve disorder, we discuss Charcot-Marie Tooth syndrome. It's a hereditary and motor and sensory neuropathy. Autosomal dominant, both genders affect equally, but male affected more. CMTX affected males. Prevalence at least 1 in 2,500 childbirth. Age of onset varies, first 2 decades of life, caused by genetic mutation, familial inherited, less commonly are sporadic. If we see this diagram, clinical picture of weakness in leg, ankle and feet, loss of muscle bulk, hand weakness, difficulty in running, foot deformity, pes cavus seen in this diagram, diminished or absent deep tendon reflex, steepage gait, usually Romberg positive, but generally no pain occur in this patient. Investigation, electromyography, genetic testing, nerve biopsy, and there is no cure for this disease. We only for supportive management. Now, third, we discuss in this lecture, third part is neuromuscular junction disorders. Neuromuscular junction disorder, we discuss myasthenia gravis. It's an autoimmune and autosomal recessive trait disorder. Weakness of skeletal muscle and fatigability or exertion. 3 clinical variety occur in myasthenia gravis. First is juvenile. Occur in late infancy and childhood, showing extraocular muscle weakness. Second is transient, born to mother with myasthenia gravis. Placental transfer of acetylcholine receptor antibodies. Third is congenital, which is rare, not related to maternal myasthenias, genetic etiology, poor response to therapy, permanent without remission. It is often associated with Hashimoto thyroiditis, some collagen vascular disease, and thymoma, mostly with adult, rarely seen in children. Ptosis and extraocular muscle weakness seen in myasthenia gravis. It's an earliest and most consistent finding. Others are dysphagia, facial weakness, feeding difficulty, poor head control, weakness of limb girdle, weakness of hand and feet muscle, rapid muscle fatigue, profound late in days and when tired. Fasciculation and sensory symptoms does not occur in myasthenia gravis. Tendon reflex may be diminished. For diagnostic part, in myasthenia gravis, electromyographic show increased jitter or blocking, anti-acetylcholine antibodies more diagnostic than biopsy. We give tensilin tests seen in this diagram. We give atrophonium 0.1 to 0.2 mg per kg IV. Ptosis and ophthalmoplasia improve within a few seconds and fatigability of other muscles decreases. For treatment part for mild and transient myasthenia gravis, cholinesterase inhibitor we give neostigmine 0.4 mg per kg IV every 4 to 6 hours or oral neostigmine bromide. Pisostigmine 1 to 7 mg per kg per day in 4 dividing dose. We give trial of steroid 0.5 mg per kg per day, IV immunoglobulin, plasmapheresis, and thymectomy. Neonatal with transient maternal transmitted myasthenia gravis require cholinesterase inhibitor only for few days or occasionally for few weeks, especially to allow feedings. Now we discuss fourth part of our lecture, which is myopathies, all muscle fiber innervated by a single motor neuron. Disorder of muscular Duchenne muscular atrophy, dystrophy. It is also known as pseudo-hypertrophy muscle dystrophy. It's an X-linked recessive located in chromosome X, caused by mutation in the DMD gene encoding for the protein dystrophin. Mostly occurring 3 to 5 years of age. Incidence is 1:3600 male, and male is more common affected. When dystrophin is defected, two things happen. Muscle cannot contract normally, which lead to weakness. As a muscle cell contract, it dedicate membrane tear, spilling the content of the cell like cytokinin, creatine kinase and myoglobins into the surrounding fluid. Dead muscle cells are replaced by fat tissue and fibrous scar, which causes pseudo hypertrophy. Affected axial and proximal muscle more than distal muscles seen in this diagram. And affected skeletal, smooth and cardiac muscle and brain also. For clinical picture, patient complain of hypertonia, fatigability, difficulty standing and walking, pseudo hypertrophy of calf and deltoid muscle, tall walking, deformity of spine, cardiomyopathy, and in this patient have low IQ. If you see this diagram, there is it's a Gower sign, evident by 3 to 6 years of age. Child trying to get up from squatting position, turn to side, lift his trunk by supporting his weight on his arm, and then stand up, supporting the body with his hand. It's a progressive course. Gower sign appear in 3 to 6 years of age, then arm weakness 6 years, patient is wheelchair bound 12 years, and poor cough and respiratory difficulty occur in 16 years. Investigation, creatine kinase have special role in this disease, rich in muscular dystrophy. It greatly increase. Muscle biopsy, we see necrosis, fat cell and fibrous tissue. We also do CT brain to see the brain atrophy. For management part, we give steroid treatment to extend the ambulated phase in DMD by 1 to 2 years. And supportive care. Death is mainly occur due to respiratory failure in this patient. Second, we discuss Becker muscular dystrophy. It's a benign pseudo hypertrophy. Similar to Duchenne muscular dystrophy, it's a X-linked recessive disease. Some dystrophin is present, but it's abnormal. It's a milder form and slowly progressive. If we differentiate both Duchenne and Becker, Duchenne occur in 3 to 5 years and Becker 5 to 15 years. Life expectancy in Duchenne is teens and Becker's have long life survival, 30 to 50 decades. Mental retardation occur in Duchenne, and if you see the dystrophin markedly decrease or even absent in Duchenne muscular dystrophy, and in Becker may be normal, but the protein itself is abnormal. Now we discuss what are the challenges that need to be addressed. Long and unpredictable duration of advanced neuromuscular disorders, wide range of symptoms, complex multidisciplinary care issues in neuromuscular disorder. Also, neuropsychiatric problem like behavioral and cognitive changes that may negatively affect communication and care planning, and the common use of assistant ventilation aid in patient with neuromuscular disorder. Then what are the barriers? From palliative side, palliative care specialists are reluctant to take other patients than those suffering from cancer on board due to limited capacity and lack of disease specific knowledge. For neurologist side, neurologists might not always see a role for palliative care in their complex patient and associated palliative care with death and dying, and are afraid to diminish patient hope by introducing palliative care. From patient side, patient themselves might be reluctant to accept a referral for reasons such as the association of palliative care with end of life care or long standing relation with neurological service and service provider. When to consider palliative care approach for patient with advanced neuromuscular disorder? A marked decline in pulmonary function, particularly forced vital capacity and peak cough flow, marked weight loss, moderate to severe pain, recurrent infection, typically pulmonary or urinary, inability to heal lesion, including pressure ulcer, swelling problem, decline. This was the article published in 2018 in Annal Palliative Medicine Journal, in which most of the neurological disorder have poor prognosis and lead to various symptoms amenable to palliative care. Author concluded that elder age and NMD diagnosis, early onset dyspnea, dysphagia, constipation, and impaired mobility within the first year after NMD diagnosis may predict mortality within the first year after diagnosis. It may provide guidance to clinician for early palliative care referral in this patient group. Now, how palliative care can help? The key to effective palliative care is communication. The basic tenets of palliative care include providing relief from pain, shortness of breath, nausea, and other distressing symptoms. It is essential to ensure that patient with neuromuscular disorder is able to understand as much as he or she want to know about the disease and to be aware of what may happen as his or her disease progresses. The intent of palliative care is to neither hasten nor postpone death, but instead to offer a supportive system to help patient live as fully as possible through the integration of medical, biopsychosocial, and spiritual aspect of patient care. This was the article published in 2016, European Journal of Neurologists, a consensus review on the development of palliative care for patients with chronic and progressive neurological disorders. The main area which consensus was found and recommended could be the early integration of palliative care, involvement of wider multidisciplinary team, communication with patient and family, including advanced care planning, symptom management, and education of all professionals involved in the care of this patient and families. Now we summarize our lecture. Most neuromuscular disorders are not amenable to curative treatment. Thus, our aim is to increase the quality of life of this patient. The key to effective palliative care is communication. We hope that we have presented a clear and logistic argument that allowed the reader to recognize need for palliative care in the management of progressive neuromuscular disease. It is a better way to manage the complexity of care in this patient population, although there is a greater need for prospective research in this area. I'm completing our lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, Vikram. It was an excellent presentation. Arun, are there any questions? I can see one comment in the chat box.
Yes, thank you. I'll just read the comment, Vikram. In Indian setting, home care is most likely possibility other than symptom relief. Is any team trained to give this multimodal care? Does any center provide training to primary caregiver to best possible care? So what Lina Uthup is wanting to know is that any center who provides training to primary caregivers to provide care to the patients apart from the doctors. Any comments on that? Not related to your topic, but if you know, you can please.
I can give the answer for this question. See, this including or integration of palliative care in any of the neuromuscular, any of the neurological disorder, it is an art. It needs different set of skills. So initially, it will be communication, and your approach should be communication and symptom based approach. We just cannot start talking that this disease is not going to be cured, and we cannot start talking about end of life care. So I have seen a couple of patients in these days in neurology department. Initially, there was a huge reluctance to send patients to us. But once they have realized that we are not only talking about death and dying, we are talking about the explaining them about the honest nature of disease, and also about the we are looking after their symptom management, they started believing us and they started welcoming us. So similarly, if we have discharged the answer to this comment, I am just saying, when we discharge two of our motor neuron disease patients and the myasthenia gravis patients, what we have done, we have given enough time to explain to the relatives that how they will take care of the patient at home. So it is not only the nurse's job, it is also the doctor's job, that nurses will be there and you have to make a nurses in your team that they will explain about the nursing care and everything. But it is your also your responsibility to explain them that how they will take care. And what I have realized, I have taken the feedback from these patients at home, one patient for motor neuron disease, another patient, that they really welcome this. They are very happy at home because now they know that what exactly the disease trajectory, what will be the disease trajectory. They are not talking about death, but they are taking care of the patient with the in a very decent manner, and they are not looking after the prolonging of life. So it will be our responsibility to empower the patients and their relatives when they are going home. And through multidisciplinary team, I think it really makes it really difficult. It is not that easy that we keep on talking that multidisciplinary team is required, but making patients and their relatives, empowering them with the multidisciplinary talent, I think it makes a huge difference. But definitely it is a challenge for a nuclear family or a person who is, there is no caregivers. It is going to be a challenge, and hospice can be the answer in that condition. But I'm just with my experience that if at all we want to integrate palliative medicine in neurology, our approach should be good communication skills and extremely satisfying symptom management. And once you will start doing, automatically that end of life care will come, because you know that symptom management includes that we will not intubate and we will not ventilate. Even the neurologists, they don't want to prolong life, but they don't have any answer. And we have seen the Australian study, which Vikram has explained, that almost 60% or 70% of neurologists, they don't feel very comfortable in disclosing the diagnosis. And almost 50% of the patient are very, very, 50% of the physicians, they feel very uncomfortable in explaining and managing the symptoms. So it is a tough job, but definitely this group of patients exist in the world, and palliative care integration can make a huge difference. And we have to step one by one. We just cannot start talking about do not intubate, do not resuscitate, because there are many myasthenia gravis patients, they come out well by immunotherapy or plasmapheresis. So we just cannot talk about the just dying. We have to keep our approach based on the good communication and symptom management. Automatically, end of dignified end will come in that. So this is my experience. I hope I have answered this question. So my informations are over. Now we can go ahead with the question. Arun, there are two, three more questions, and we have 12 minutes, so we can take the question answer. And any other comments from anybody? Those who are treating neurological patients in their department, please go ahead with your comments. Arun, there are questions.
Thank you, Vikram.
Yes, sir.
Is there any role of artificial nutrition or hydration in motor neuron disease? That is the question.
Yes, sir. We give artificial hydration or nutrition mainly by giving NG tubes or percutaneous endoscopic gastrostomy. But we also see the expectancy of patient life. If patient life is less than 6 weeks, then we are not recommended for the end of life mainly. We are not recommended for artificial nutrition. And
No. They are talking about the IV artificial nutrition. I think there is no role of artificial nutrition in these patients.
Yes.
So with NG tube and gastrostomy, we are going to give enteral feeding. There is a role, but artificial nutrition, I don't think there is any role.
Yes, there is no need for total parenteral nutrition for artificial nutrition or hydration. For someone who is not eating orally, that TPN should not be advocated. That is what the question is. But your point is well taken, Vikram.
So if there are no, are there any other question, Arun?
No, madam, there are no further question. Thank you.
So it was an excellent presentation, Vikram. I was really very, because it was difficult to talk about everything, neuromuscular disorders. It was difficult to talk in 40 minutes. And I told you that you will finish in 40 or maximum 45 minutes. You finished in time. And I think you have covered a lot. So thank you very much. Have a nice week. And we will see you again next week.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone.